stranger.
Greetings, travellers, and welcome to episode 77 of the Innsworth Book Club podcast. As you can see today, we've brought you to a new area, the Squid Inn, tucked away on the harbour of Innsworth. I'm one of your hosts, Tim Mendes.
And I'm the other one, Rob Poyton. Yes, the owner here, the publican, has kindly given us use of the TV lounge at the back of the inn. Because as we mentioned last time, we're going to be running a sort of mini series over the next maybe half dozen or so episodes, where we're delving into the murky world of Lovecraftian television.
We've got some interesting shows lined up, and today is my choice, my first one, and it's not Doctor Who. We'll probably surprise a lot of people. Today we're going to be looking at the BBC sci-fi sitcom Red Dwarf, specifically the episode Back to Reality.
Excellent. Yeah, so that's going to be the format. One of us or a guest is going to choose a particular series, and then they'll also choose one episode from it that they think best sort of epitomizes the show from the Lovecraft perspective, I guess. Yeah, we've got a very interesting list of programs to get through.
Yeah.
So we're looking forward to chatting with some of our guests about those as well. I should just mention the owner here did ask me just to mention Walter the barman did say, can you remind your people, your guests, that it's comedy club on a Friday night, and on Saturday night you can get two cocktails for the price of one in Dagon's bar, and Thursday night is ladies night.
Oh, is the feeling right?
You've turned into a disco goth.
Yeah, no, I don't know where that came from. The pits of my brain.
Yeah. But before we get into all that, I believe you've got a new anthology coming out. Is that right?
Yeah, it's just released. It's called The Call of Darker Skies, and it's a shared world anthology. It was sort of one of those project, so it's actually been in the works for a long time. I'd actually forgotten about it. But I wrote a novelette called Sky Truffles, which is Hodgson inspired, but it's a steampunk Lovecraftian thing, so it's all airships and tentacles in the sky and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, so it's pretty bonkers, but it's really good fun.
Oh, that sounds great. When's that due out?
It's just released. It just came out. Yeah. You can get hold of that on Amazon now on ebook and paperback.
Well, I should be adding that to my basket, No doubt. And my main project I've been busy with lately is my Dragon's Teeth YouTube gaming channel, where I'm covering all aspects of gaming, from tabletop war gaming to RPGs. I'm reviewing books and rules, and if you want to see me struggling and swearing, trying to paint tiny little figures that are 10 millimetres high, then there's a bit of that as well. And of course, I've had a very esteemed guest. I was privileged to interview none other than a certain Tim Mendes about Lovecraft, your top five Lovecraft video games, isn't it?
Indeed, yeah, I had fun with that. Yeah, I'd like to come back because I want to do my top five most obscure Lovecraftian video games.
Yeah. Because this is an area you've been heavily researching.
Indeed.
By researching, I mean playing a lot of video games.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. How I don't have carpal tunnel syndrome yet is a miracle.
You're getting through lots of bags of what's-its, Ashley.
Tubes of Pringles, yeah.
All right, so let's take a seat, everyone. Make sure everyone's got a drink. They're doing a nice range of snacks at the bar as well, including the ever favourite sea nuggets, of course. So once everyone has settled down, we will start the show.
Stay away from the jellied shoggoths.
So, Red Dwarf. Now, this is... I was surprised how many series it ran for, actually, but when did it start and how did it begin?
Well, it started in the late 80s. It was originally a radio play. It was called Dave Holland's Space Cadet. It was written by Rob Grant and Doug Naylor and was broadcast on Radio 4 as part of the Son of Cliché in the mid-80s, which was sort of like it was almost like a comedy playhouse kind of thing, but for radio scripts.
Right. I have to say, yeah, I don't remember it at all, but then I probably wasn't listening to radio much at that time.
Yeah, and they basically they wanted to go off and make a TV show of it. But at this point, you've got to remember at this time, the sort of late 80s, sort of 88, 87, 88, this is the same time that the BBC cancelled Doctor Who. It was Michael Grade who was the director general, and he hated sci-fi, like with a passion.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he hated it. He didn't see any value in it whatsoever. And so that was that was a major hurdle. And how they got around with it, because they went to, it was Peter Jackson, who was the producer, who's best known for his work on things like The Two Ronnies and The Young Ones and stuff like that. He was, and obviously because of the popularity of The Young Ones, he was one of these guys that they basically just gave him recording blocks and said, do what you like. do what you like, mate.
Nice. Yeah.
You can have it. And it was actually for another show, which was like a standard sitcom. They had this blocked off for this, but he got the scripts and was kind of like, well, you know what? I'm just going to fuck that off and sneak this in.
It just went sneaked in, yeah.
Yeah. So that's basically how it happened.
And I can see a sort of connection with The Young Ones in terms of that. It's that at the time, it's very much that younger sort of quotes alternative comedy approach, isn't it? Rather than you know, Married with Two Kids kind of sitcom stuff.
Yeah. Well, absolutely. And if you look at all the cast, all the cast come from the alternative comedy scene, and the director of most of, like, the, I think, yeah, from all the series except 6 up to 8, right, were produced by Ed Bye, who was best known for producing Bottom and Filthy Rich and Cat Flap.
I love it.
And The Vicar of Dibley. Yeah.
Wow, that's an odd mix.
Yeah, yeah.
Someone's going to snip this out and use it against me at some point, but I have to say I love Bottom.
Yeah, Bottom's amazing. But that was the joke of it, wasn't it? That was why it was called Bottom, because it, did you see Bottom? And the episodes were like cut like apostrophe S out. So it's Bottoms Out and Up as well. So Bottoms Up. You know?
Yeah,
so that was sort of the production behind it, was these guys who were heavily into it. And so obviously the humour was in line with what they've been doing, that sort of almost anarchic humour, you know, sort of quite irreverent and all around it. But it was such an incredibly different concept at the time. I mean, we've had quite a few sci-fi comedies now, but if you look at the first two series, it was essentially like The Odd Couple in space, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's very true, yeah. Because I didn't really appreciate it until watching it again the other night. Dave Lister is the only human character in it. It's quite odd, isn't it?
Yeah, he is.
I mean, and that doesn't mean it's full of aliens or whether, or a crew of aliens. It just means, well, we'll get to that when we go through the casting.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's already quite an odd start. In a way, quite bleak already is the last human.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was the whole point. Like the first series, like especially like the first episode is called The End. And it starts off with everybody on Red Dwarf is fully crewed, people, all the rest of it. Lister's been in trouble for smuggling a cat aboard, right? He's got this pet cat because he's just split up with his girlfriend. So he's smuggled a cat, you know, he's done that thing, right? And he's got rumbled. Now he can either hand over the cat gets destroyed, Lister carries on, or he can get put in stasis, which is like prison kind of thing, right? And miss out on an entire tour's pay.
Right.
Because they're on the Jupiter Mining Corporation spaceship, the Red Dwarf.
And this is a huge ship, right?
Yeah, it's enormous. Yeah. Yeah. And so obviously Lister chooses to get put on ice, basically. And while this happens, somebody, spoiler alert, Rimmer, didn't reseal the drive plates properly because he was basically a numpty and there was a radiation leak and everybody got turned into dust. So when Lister comes out, he's walking around and there's all this powder on things and he's like dabbing it, going, I've eaten half the crew, you know. Yeah. And the ship's computer, Holly, brings back a hologram of Rimmer, who was his bunkmate, to keep him sane. which is the worst possible idea.
It's the last person you'd want, isn't it, to spend eternity with.
God, can you imagine? Yeah, insufferable prat. And they think they're alone, but then they find out that there's another life form on board who evolved from Lister's cat. That is cat. But all the other cats have left. They had like a holy war over stupid coloured hats and left in arcs and leaving him aboard because he was off somewhere looking at shiny things or something. I don't know. But,
So, yeah, it's a very interesting setup. And already, you know, obviously we're looking at this from a Lovecraftian context.
Mm.
Already you could see this could be incredibly dark and cosmic.
Yeah.
It does weave that into the humour. The best British humour always does that, right? There's always that underlying tragedy very close to the humour as well.
Yeah.
But, of course, it takes it into a very comedic direction.
Yeah, there's some heavy concepts in it. There's some heavy sci-fi concepts, which we'll get to some of them later on. But, the whole beginning bit is they're 3 million years into deep space, and he's the last human being alive. Yeah, it's pretty bleak, right?
Yeah, it is, yeah. There was a comedy series from the States a few years back. Was it The Last Man Alive or Last Man on Earth?
Oh, yeah.
That was very good as well.
That was like a comedy take on I Am Legend, wasn't it?
It was, yeah. He ends up, he paints a face on a football, you know, and he's talking to it.
Yeah.
And then, of course, he finds some other survivors. And actually, what I like, the same in this as well, the last survivor or the sole survivor is not this heroic kind of Rambo figure. It was the same in that series. It's just some, I don't know what he was, like he sold air conditioning units or something, you know. But it's and the same with Lister, because he's like, he's not your chisel-jawed space pilot, is he?
No, he's a slob. And he's the lowest ranking crew member, the third technician. He's the only person that Rimmer outranks. You know, and he basically is a complete and total slob. You know, he sits around eating curries, drinking lager, and all this kind of stuff. And that's where a lot of the comedy comes from. It's like, you know, this is the hope. This is all our hope is in this complete and total numpty. You know,
which it subverts all the normal expectations, doesn't it? Mm. You know, thinking back to the science fiction of Clark Ashton Smith we've been reading. With the brave Captain Volmar and his crew of chaps. This is like the antidote to that stuff, isn't it?
Yeah. It's funny because the Red Dwarf crew before they got wiped out, there was people like Todd Hunter, who was very much this suave, clean-cut officer class type, you know. But no, he's turned to dust and you've got, you know. And then it's funny, like you were saying about the football with the face on it. It's like the first two series is, because Crichton comes into it as a guest in the second series, but he's only in one episode and it's played by somebody different. It's played by David Ross.
Oh, right.
So he doesn't properly come into it until series three. So the first series, you've basically got Holly, the ship's computer.
Yeah.
Rimmer, Lister, and the cat. And they spend a lot of their time bickering with inanimate objects. Like, one of my favourite characters throughout the whole of the series is Talkie Toaster. He's basically a toast-obsessed appliance, you know. Do you want some toast? Shut up.
This is quite prescient, right? Because now you can get
Alexa.
Toasters that will link to the internet. And I'm not quite sure why. Yeah, and in fact, someone was just saying the other night, I can turn all my lights on with my app and the heat in and everything else, you know. That was looking ahead, wasn't it, really?
Yeah. Talkie Toaster is an absolute hero. I think it reappeared in, like, the last series that was made, which was only a few years ago.
Right.
I think Talkie Toaster reappeared in that. It's one of them characters that keeps popping up. Sort of enduring. It's like another classic moment. I think it was in series eight, was Rimmer had a nemesis all the way through this, and it turned out to be a chocolate dispenser who was voiced by Tony Slattery.
Oh, Tony Slattery, right.
That was basically Ribber's nemesis all the way through. It was a fucking chocolate dispenser.
I've had a couple of fights with vending machines in the past, so I can kind of see that.
There was a whole episode of Lister falling in love with a vending machine and things like that as well. It's just these concepts, though. It's just really funny because, like, you look at the way, you know, AI and all that kind of stuff. You can see this happening, right?
Even the character of Holly. I mean, you mentioned Alexa before. Yep. That's what. Well, it was he, then she, wasn't it? I guess originally. Yep. But that is Alexa, isn't it? You know.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It was Holly. It was Norman Lovett, then Hattie Heyridge, then back to Norman Lovett.
Yeah, and I suppose that in itself was a bit of a riff on 2001.
It was Hal.
Was it Hal? Yeah. Wasn't it? What are you doing, Dave?
Kind of thing. But again, it was an incredibly incompetent computer. They had what did he call it? Computer senility. Basically, you know, the ship's computer had gone doolally because it was alone for 3 million years.
Well, that would do it, wouldn't it?
You know, yeah, because it's that classic line. I think I've got a bit peculiar, if I'm honest.
I'm sure we've all said that from time to time.
Yeah, exactly.
And this is written by a writing team, right? A pair of writers.
Yes, Rob Grant and Doug Naylor, who were at university together. I believe it was Manchester University. So, again, we mentioned in a previous episode that there was that Manchester sort of comedy scene. And this was all part of it.
Yeah.
That northern comedy scene. All these guys, Peter Jackson, Ed By, Rob Grant, Doug Naylor, most of the cast, they were all part of that thing.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, and they written it, like I said, as a radio play. Later on, after series six, Rob Grant left. And so Doug Naylor basically went on to write it all himself. But he ended up having Robert Llewellyn, who played Crichton, wrote a couple of episodes as well.
Oh, right.
Yeah, which is really, really cool, you know, because Robert Llewellyn is one of them guys that just makes me laugh.
Yeah.
I don't know why. He doesn't really have to do anything. He just makes me laugh. Like, because, you know, when he's on Scrap Heap Challenge, he's just one of them chaps that just makes me laugh. So, you know.
And am I right in saying they worked on things like Spitting Image together and that sort of stuff as well?
Yeah.
And I like the fact that they sometimes went under the name Grant Naylor, like a combination.
Yeah. Yeah. Grant Naylor was their production name. Executive producer, Grant Naylor.
That's nice.
Yeah. You're right. They did work on Spitting Image, and that's where they met Chris Barry.
Of course, yeah.
Who played Rimmer.
Because Chris Barry was not the original... Well, he was one of a few people who went for the audition for Rimmer, if I'm correct.
He originally went for Lister.
Ah, right.
And got rejected for that, and they said you'd be better off reading for Rimmer.
And the two people, two of the other people did go for it, were quite surprising to me, I have to say. Because we had Alan Rickman and Alfred Molina. Molina.
Well, Molina actually got it, didn't he?
Right.
He actually got it, but then basically when they were going to film it, it got cancelled because of strikes at the time. It may have been the asbestos thing at Shepperton. I can't remember. It was basically it got cancelled and it had to be remounted. And when they were going to remount it, he couldn't do it.
Oh, he had other things going on. Yeah. Because I suppose Alan Rickman then wasn't quite into films, if we're talking sort of...
No.
He would have just been not just starting out necessarily. He probably had quite a lot of stage experience. But he certainly was the Alan Rickman that he was to become then, was he? Yeah.
Well, it was pre-Die Hard.
Yeah.
You know, because that was his sort of his big...
That was his big break, yeah.
His big break, wasn't it? It was Die Hard. And I think it was definitely before then. So, yeah. that'd be really interesting, wouldn't it? Rickman as Rimmer. I don't know if it had worked.
Yeah, but you can't... Because now you can just think of him as that...
Yeah.
Alan Rickman, that character, right? But I can kind of see it. But then he did do the role in the Galaxy Quest, didn't he, later on?
Oh, I'd forgotten about that.
That was the it was the kind of Spock role, wasn't it?
It was the Spock role. Yeah. That's exactly what it was.
He did that very well, didn't he? That was a great film, actually.
Well, actually, then I could probably see it working because Rimmer's thing is that he's overly officious. He's always quoting regulations and stuff, but basically like he's a shit version of the Spock character.
Yeah, yeah. It, yeah, it's the pound version. Shop Spock.
Yeah, Dan hasn't got a clue what he's talking about.
There's a band name, Pound Shop Spock.
Just Chop Spock. Yeah, love it.
A bit like half man, half biscuit kind of band, I think.
Oh, that'd be brilliant. Yeah. There is a band called Spock's Brain. Oh,
there is, isn't there? And Spock's Beard as well, I think. Isn't there?
Spock's Beard. Yeah, and there's Spock.
All right, just Spock.
German synth pop band, and all their songs are about Klingons and stuff.
Ooh.
Their big hit was Never Trust a Klingon. Ooh. It's something I actually play when I DJ. It's a great track.
I'll be checking those out later then. So the other cast members. Oh, let's talk about Cat, because I believe that Danny John-Jules, who played Cat, had quite an interesting audition.
Oh, God. This is absolute genius. But I'll just jump back a bit first, because Craig Charles was a punk poet at the time, a part of the alternative comedy scene. So he basically came up and did lots of, angry poetry, that kind of stuff, right? A lot of it about race and all this sort of stuff. And Rob and Doug knew him from, because obviously he was Liverpool. There was the comedy circuit around there, and they knew him. So when they wrote the character of Cat, they went to Craig Charles and asked him, "Do you think the character could be perceived as being racist?"
Ah.
And he was like, "Nah, the character's cool."
Right.
And while he was doing it, he was like, "I really like the Lister character. Do you mind if I read for it?" And that's how he got into it.
Oh, right. So it wasn't written for him as such, that just almost by accident.
No, originally, apparently, according to Doug Naylor, apparently Lister was originally supposed to be a Cockney.
Oh, if only I'd have known, I could have gone for that.
Yeah, yeah. So there you go. And so with the Cat character, they wanted somebody who oozed cool and all this kind of stuff. So when they put the call out for it, Mr. Danny John-Jules, who was a dancer and an actor, he's he does like choreography and stage and all that kind of stuff. He's a very good dancer. He's like and a singer as well.
Oh, right.
And he's also probably best known apart from this role. He was in Scum, and he was also in Maid Marian's Merry Men. He was the rapping Jamaican chap,
right?
When he saw the role, he was thinking, "What it epitomized cool." So he went to his dad's house and borrowed his dad's old zoot suit. Right, so he dressed up in this zoot suit, all this, looking proper dapper, right? And he turned up to the audition. I think it was about an hour late, 2 hours late. But he didn't realise, so he just walked in, didn't apologise, just walked in, started doing his thing, right, slinking around, because he's a dancer, so he was moving, he's got the moves, he's sort of slinking around the place, and they were like, "Yeah, you've got it." And it was only afterwards that he found out that he was late for the audition.
Brilliant. So it's like another happy accident in a way, isn't it? That just epitomises Cats, doesn't it, really? So.
Well, exactly. I mean, that was, apparently they'd seen like several people that day, and some of them did read the lines well, or they moved well, but nobody put it all together. And then in slinks Danny John-Jules in his zoot suit,
That is, you can't imagine anyone else doing that role, actually. That is spot on.
Right. Yeah, and for Ship's Computer, Holly, they wanted somebody deadpan. So they went for the best deadpan comedian of the time, which was Mr. Norman Lovett, he was a stand-up comic, and his entire thing was, it was basically dead, laconic.
Yes, deadpan. Yeah, very much.
He was like a precursor to Jack D, wasn't he? He was this grumpy old sod, basically.
Yeah, I suppose he was now. Yeah, that very much that persona, wasn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, which is why when he stepped away after series two, they wanted a replacement. They got in Hattie Heydrich, because she was known as the female Norman Lovett on the comedy circuit. She had another stand-up. Yeah, they were. There was one episode. The final episode of series two was they go to a parallel universe, right? And so there's another Rimmer, another Lister,
Right.
But they're female. So there's a female Holly. So that's what she was in it then. So when he stepped away, they were just like, look, you've done it before. It was really good. Do you want the job?
Yeah.
And like I said about Crichton, the original Crichton was David Ross, who was best known for things like The Green, Green Grass. And he was in Boys in the Black Stuff as well. But he also voiced Talkie Toaster.
Oh, right.
So he stayed
in it.
Yeah, he stayed in it as Talkie Toaster. He was supposed to come back full time as Crichton, but he couldn't because of other commitments. And he was a much camper take on Crichton than what we got. You got the really bumble buffoon Jeeves in Space thing from Robert Llewellyn, right? Who we mentioned? Yeah, he was a comedy actor. He'd been in a couple of sitcoms, so he had a memorable part in Bottom. He played the Falklands veteran with the antique wooden leg.
Yes, I remember
that Rick Mayall nicks, you know. Yeah. And then he went on to host Scrap Heap Challenge. Now, there was also another character, which was just a recurring character, his listeners' love interest, Christine Kachansky, who was a navigation officer. Now, the first six series, again, it was only a guest role, so it popped up like maybe once, maybe twice a series, right? It was originally played by Claire Grogan, who was the singer in Altered Images.
Altered Images, yeah.
Happy birthday, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, yeah. Which was a huge hit in the 80s, wasn't it? They were a pretty big band, actually, didn't they?
They were. They did some really good stuff, actually. I'm quite a big fan of Altered Images.
Yeah.
But from series 7 and 8, again, she wasn't available. So they recast as full time for those two series. And it was Chloe Annette who played her.
Right.
And she was best known for like period dramas and things like that. She was in things like Poirot and Marple and all that kind of stuff. Right. Yeah. But I think she did a really good job. She spent most of series 7 swanning about in skin tight red PVC. So that gets my vote right from the start.
It's a tough job, but someone has to do it.
Exactly right. Yeah. And over the years, they've had some great guest appearances as well. In fact, two of which are in this episode we're going to be looking at in a bit. So I'll leave them for now and come back to them. But we had Frances Barber, one of her first roles. She played the polymorph, basically a sultry dominatrix type who seduces the cat.
Right.
Tony Slattery as the chocolate machine, who was said about. Yeah. Sophie Winkleman played a hologram in one of them that basically plays this sort of like ball busting Russian officer who usurps Rimmer's command, sort of thing. You've got Jenny Agutter.
All right. Wow. She's a veteran of stage and screen.
Mm. Well, Railway Children, right?
Well, Railway Children, yeah. And American Werewolf in London.
Exactly. Brian Cox.
Right, yeah.
Not the science guy, the actor guy.
And Space Brilliant.
Yeah. Yeah, always makes me laugh. So, he's got my accent, right? He's a Manx. So he hit Space Gate. Yeah. This is one of the best ones. Ainsley Herriot, the TV chef.
Wow.
Before he was a TV chef, he played a Guelph.
Yeah. Wow. I guess it's always been the case to an extent, and certainly even more now. A lot of people you see in shows as a chef or something else might not have been chefs to start. Shall we put it like that? You know,
yeah.
It's a little bit, people like go on The Apprentice,
yeah,
with the aim of becoming a TV presenter or celebrity or influencer or whatever it is these days, isn't it? So,
yeah.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, yeah. He played a Guelph. Yeah.
Mm.
Which brings me nicely, because I'm going to talk now about some of the weird and wonderful creatures of the Red Dwarf universe.
Yes.
There is some corkers. The Guelphs were genetically engineered life forms. They were like these big, hairy yeti type people with huge pendulous breasts. and they all fancy Lister for some reason. Lister actually has a Gelf bride in one of them because they need an oxygen unit, so they trade because they've got like a barter system. But the trade is that Rimmer has, that Lister has to marry this Gelf. And basically they leg it. Like with the thing, right? They do a runner. So they send the emo hawk after them, which is a polymorph, is a domesticated polymorph. Now, I briefly mentioned the polymorph a minute ago. It's basically like a thing-like creature.
Right, yeah.
Which in its true form looks a bit like a xenomorph, but with a sucker mouth. And it sucks out people's emotions. But it can turn into anything it wants, like a bunny rabbit, a snake, any of these things, right, to get a reaction. So it turns into Rimmer's mum and is having sex with Lister to make Rimmer throw a wobbler and then sucks right. out his anger.
And then feeds on the emotion.
Francis Barber turns up to the cat, strokes his ego, and then sucks out his vanity. Yeah. You know, so then in that one with the Gelf, this crossbred, this like domesticated version of it, which comes aboard and does the same things again, but it actually turns Cat into the character that we're going to be seeing in a minute.
Ah,
it's the first time you get a recurrence of Mr. Dwayne Dibley.
Right. So that was that pre this episode or
no?
After?
No. It was after. It was after.
It was after. Right. Well, I think it was such a good character that to bring it back.
Yeah, it was in series 6.
Right.
Yeah. Polymorph 2 Emo Hawk.
Oh, yeah. We're in series 5, aren't we, for the episode we're going to look at. Yeah.
Yeah. Some other creatures with a sort of, you know, Lovecraftian bent. I think the most for me would be the Sirens, who are these, again, they're shapeshifters, but they're giant bugs, almost like Mego.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember.
Kind of thing. Yeah. But they suck out people's brains. But they lure you onto the rocks. You know, they lurk in asteroid belts. They lure you onto the rocks. And then they trick you with all this thing. So for Lister, it was Kachansky turning up on a video thing in a gunfight. So she's like, let's go rescue her. And they're like, you're right. Being an idiot.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's like kind of peering into people's memories then and taking something out that's going to be a lure for them.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So I think they're really. It's a shame they didn't appear in anything else like any other episodes because they were such a great concept. I thought the Sirens. I nearly chose that for this, but I thought we kind of had to go with this one for many reasons. Another one of my favourite episodes is in this series, and it's the episode Quarantine. And Rimmer gets a holo virus and goes batshit crazy. And one of my favourite characters in anything, not just Red Dwarf, in anything turns up. And I've brought him here. It's Mr. Flibble.
So our guests can see that, our visitors. Mr. Flibble, the penguin.
Yeah, it's a penguin hand puppet. A psychotic penguin hand puppet.
I'm already thinking Tekalili and the Mountains of Madness.
Yeah, exactly. The Mountains of Madness. There you go. But yeah, Mr. Flibble will fry you alive with his hex vision. Yeah. Mr. Flibble is very cross. Yeah. It's randomly enough, I actually saw a guy wearing a Mr. Flibble is very cross t-shirt the other day in town.
Oh,
just like, wait, cool. I nearly went up to it and asked him where he got it. we've also had the Inquisitor, who is a self-repairing simulant that time travels and goes back through time and erases people who've wasted their lives.
Again, that's quite grim, isn't it, really? It could be potentially quite dark.
Oh, yeah, it's quite yeah. It's one of those, if you think about it, too much. It's a bit there. Another one for that was Angels and Demons, where there was a triplicator, and they were doing strawberries. So they turned one into three, but one would be really good, one would be rotten.
Right.
And it goes wonky and replicates Red Dwarf.
Ah.
So you've got one ship and they're all like angels, you know, and come on, my brothers, let's listen to some meditation music. And then the other one, and they're all crazies, right? So Rimmer's in like this sort of almost like Julian Clary dominatrix kind of outfit. I'm going to thrash you for an inch of your life kind of thing, right? And Lister's this crazed, like almost like a biker type, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And the cat's this bit like a werewolf. Which is, I always like the concept in that because it's, you know, it's taking the good bits and the bad bits and all that kind of stuff. So some of the concepts are great, like the white hole.
Mm.
They doesn't suck time out, it spews time into the universe, so they kept getting random repetitions and weird shit going on.
I was going to say, we get some obvious things, you know, and, and at the time we've got Alien, and I was thinking with that good bad, that's like the Star Trek episode, you know, that funnily enough has Spock's, the bearded Spock in it, Spock's beard.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, and lots of time travel, but there was a lot of new stuff as well, a lot of really good ideas.
Yeah,
I think it's interesting as well. It's something we speak about, this idea of humor in the Lovecraft universe as well. Now, perhaps that sort of humor prompts some clever ideas as well. You know, it's not just all gloom and destruction, is it?
No, well, it's like the white hole, right? Which is a proper scientific concept, but it's and it's really, you know, when you think about it, it's quite brain melting. But the way they do it is hilarious. Because you've got like this one scene where they keep jumping back to the start like a record that's stuck, and there's this recurring joke that Cat just keeps going, so what is it? And then and they have to then explain it and keep explaining it, but it turns out at the end he's just arsing about. Will somebody punch him out?
Nice.
Yeah, but I think two of my favourite concepts one of the two is in this episode we're going to look at now, which is, you know, the Despair Squid.
Yes, yes, a very neat idea. So let's take a look, shall we?
Yeah, Back to Reality was the sixth episode of Series 5 and was broadcast on BBC Two on the 26th of March 1992. It was directed by Juliet May and Grant Naylor. So, Rob and Doug, basically. And the first thing you notice is that awesome theme music. I've always loved the theme music to Red Dwarf.
Yes, that was Howard Goodall, I think, wasn't it? Who was also very well known for doing things like Blackadder and many other things as well. Yes.
Classic FM's composer in residence as well, apparently.
Oh, right.
Yeah, apparently. Yeah. And you notice then, like, the model work I always thought was tremendous as well.
Actually, I was thinking that, looking back at this, because we get Starbug, which is like the little kind of, well, it's like a big shuttle craft, I suppose, that comes out underwater. And that thing always fascinated me. Funnily enough, that's something I'm going to talk about next time when we cover our next show, with spaceships that go underwater.
Yeah.
Because in a way, why wouldn't they? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Are they they're kind of the same environments, but then quite different in some ways as well, perhaps. We've come to that sticky point where we look at our scientific knowledge and you can fit it on the back of a matchbox.
Yeah, there is that. But brings to mind the Clark Asher Smith's ether ship, right? Because, you know, the Mego with the wings that can traverse the ether, because... You know,
well, that was the commonly held belief back in the day, was that space wasn't empty, it was filled with this,
it's like a liquid
substance almost. Yeah,
yeah,
so yeah. And I thought as you say, the model work, the real effects all really stood up today, still, it looked really good.
Yeah, they actually won awards for the effects, and specifically the episode Gunman of the Apocalypse, they won an Emmy for that.
Wow,
the two of the main guys on the model and effects were Peter Ragg and Mike Tucker, who any fan of Doctor Who will know. They were the guys that did most of the effect work.
So they're
all the way back to the early 70s.
Oh, really? So they're well experienced. Yeah. Oh, back to the halcyon days of Mr. Pertwee and co.
Yeah, Pertwee Baker, that era. When they brought it in-house to the BBC, because they used to, before that, it was like outside people doing it, and that's why the results varied so wildly, right? Some of them were great.
The bubble wrap and sellotape kind of.
When they brought it in-house at the BBC, Tucker, Mike Tucker and Peter Ragg were two of the main guys.
And the Starbug here, we learn as we go along, he's looking for a black box from this sort of crashed, this huge, is it a spaceship or is it an undersea sort of installation or something?
It's an ocean seeding vessel, but it is it's spacefaring. Yeah. The SSS Esperanto. And basically, it's been terraforming this planet, basically kick-starting evolution, basically putting like amino acids into it and basically arsing about with it.
Which I thought already we've got a nice Lovecraftian concept there with that idea of seeding a planet.
Yeah.
And this advanced technological race. Well, they're not just seeding the planet, are they? They're really accelerating evolution as well.
Yeah.
Which again takes us straight back to the mountains of madness.
Indeed. Yeah. And I like that they basically got 5 million years of evolution in 3 solar years.
That's quite something when you think about it.
Yeah. Yeah, so then we cut to Crichton, Lister, and the cat, who have gone onto the Esperanto to look for the black box, and they're walking around, and they've been talking about this, and you know, Lister has to ask the question. Then, you know, if this place is supposed to be teeming with life, where are they all?
Yes, there's nothing there, right? There's nothing around. There's no fish. There's nothing going on, which then begs the question, well, why is there nothing around? Is it because something has eaten it all?
Well, that's what he says, isn't it? Some giant leviathan has porked his way through the entire ocean.
We even get leviathan. So straight away, we're underwater. We've got an absence of life, and we've got a leviathan-like monster. I mean, it's, you know, not hard to draw parallels there, is it?
No, it's really not. No. And then you get, and then you find the first of many suicides.
Hmm.
Rimmer says it looks like Norman Bates' mum, which I thought was a nice Robert Block nod.
Yes, absolutely, And then we get the immortal line, why would a haddock kill itself?
And why am I even asking that question?
Why am I even asking?
It's just the way they say it. This fish killed itself by voluntarily closed its own gills. Have you seen this fish committed suicide?
Which is a wonderful concept. I mean, you know, it's not wonderful for the haddock, but it's very interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. And as they go along, they find various other dead bodies, and then they find this substance, which is basically squid ink.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yes.
And Crichton freaks out because he does like a test on it. It's like, oh God, it's hallucinogenic. Oh God.
Yeah, he works out very quickly. I guess he's got like inbuilt sensors and that kind of thing. This is like the inbuilt version of a tricorder or something.
Yeah.
Because he works out very quickly. Yeah, it's hallucinogenic venom that induces despair.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's when we're introduced to the Despair Squid, which Rimmer describes as a blob the size of New Mexico, about 2,000 fathoms above them. And Lister replies, well, you could have lied. You could have said it was a bit further away. He says, I was lying. It's only 1,000 fathoms.
It's only 1,000, yeah. And this is absolutely heading for them. It's increasing speed. It looks like it's just going to ram into them, smash them to pieces.
Yeah, yeah. This is another classic Lister line here. The way I can see it, there's only 3 options. It either thinks we're a threat, food, or a mate. So it's either going to kill us, eat us, or hump us.
Which, again, to me, is perfectly Lovecraftian.
Yeah.
Because the motivations of these creatures are totally unknown to us.
Mm.
But those are the base 3 motivations, right? Is it Maslow's hierarchy of needs?
Yeah, right? Yeah, exactly. That's it.
That's pretty much the bottom of the pyramid.
Yeah, that's it. Now, yeah, cat's a great line, you know. To get diddled by a giant squid on the first date. Think how we'd feel in the morning. Let's get out of here. So they try and get away, and as they're getting away, you get the shadow of the squid.
Yeah, that was nice. Again, you don't actually see the creature, but you see whether this—it's like either the ink coming for him, or it's the shadow, or it's not quite determinate, but it's getting closer, right? There's no escape.
I think that is really effective. And the interesting thing is that they originally shot the squid. They did special effects of the squid creature, but they decided that it looked a bit crap and they couldn't get it to look how they wanted it. So they just thought, sod it, let's just use it, but shoot its shadow. Yeah, and I think that was the right call. I think it's like Alien, isn't it? So effective because you don't see all of it. You see a bit of it or a shadow of it or, it's like back to the mezzo tint, The one thing that ruined that for me, that BBC adaptation a couple of years ago, was the bit at the end where it comes through the window. If they'd just put the hands and fade to black, that would have been great.
Yeah, just seeing the hands come over and a shape come in would have been just enough.
And I think they made the right call there just by having the shadow creeping in because it's a creeping shadow of a squid. I
Yeah,
mean,
it works really well.
it's incredibly Lovecraftian.
Yeah, that's all you need. That's all you need to know. Yeah. And there's a Frances Barber again there, right? Was she in the
Yes,
Mezzo too?
she
She
was
was,
indeed.
wasn't she?
Yeah.
Yeah. Little connection.
Yeah, that is. Yeah, that's interesting. I hadn't thought about that. Well, there's another connection to Frances Barber in this one, which we'll get to in a minute.
Ah,
And then, yeah, so they're fleeing the squid and they crash.
well, yeah, it's crash and then explode, right? And you're sort of
Yep.
thinking, ah, okay, this is interesting. And then we get flashes up on the screen, game over.
Game over. Yeah.
And we cut to a totally different time and place with these the characters. I suppose it's like VR goggles, isn't it? They're hooked up to some machine, and they're waking up and coming out of this. Was it 3, 4 years or something?
4 years.
4 years, and they've been immersed in this virtual reality computer game. The whole thing was just a game.
Which is a great concept. It's like the Matrix, isn't it?
Yeah,
Well,
yeah.
I said that at the time when I went to see the Matrix, I was like, it's basically a fucking rip off of Red
Well, who
Dwarf.
knows, you know?
Yeah, so they've been in this it's a total immersion video game. And there's hundreds of these booths around the place, right? Because, well, we find out that this is a proper dystopia, right? We find out about that in a bit with the posters. So we'll
Oh,
talk about
yeah.
that more there.
It's proper V for Vendetta kind of setup, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And then in comes the attendant, a brilliant guest star, Mr. Timothy Spall. One of my heroes. I love
With the great
that
Brummie accent as well.
guy. Like Rimmer says, how are we supposed to know that yet, Brummy Git? But interestingly, he was very well known at the time, but worked on things like Our Venus Ain't Pet and all that kind of stuff, right? But apparently, he had never worked in front of a studio audience before, whereas all of the Red Dwarf cast came from stand up and things like that, so they were used to working an audience. He was only used to working film,
Right.
so he was really panicking. And he was going through it like a million miles an hour. He had a real problem with his nerves on the
Wow.
thing. This footage on one of the documentaries, but and they basically like, Tim, just chill out. And apparently, they took him for a beer back in the studio, and he was absolutely
And he
fine
was
after
all
that
right after
point.
that. That's
Yeah,
interesting, isn't
because his delivery is fantastic.
Oh,
So it's
yeah, that
interesting.
doesn't come across in the performance at
No,
all. He looks
yeah,
really quite laid back and
it's
yeah, quite biting, isn't he, his character? Twonks, he calls them, isn't
Yeah,
it? Yeah,
what a
bunch
bunch
of
of twonks.
twonks.
No wonder they only scored 4%. Blimey, what a bunch of twonks.
I just wanted to mention with this idea of the VR totally immersive computer game as well. I just read a book. Actually, it was one of our guests at the Innsmouth Literary Festival, Dave Cartwright, written a book called Rendered Flesh, which is a zombie book. And, I like a good zombie film and zombie book, but you sort of think, well, what sort of new, no one's going to do anything new with the zombie genre. But he's done exactly that. He's put his characters into a total immersion virtual reality game in a zombie apocalypse. I won't say any more than that in terms of spoilers, but you've got their lives in the real world and then in a virtual reality world.
Nice.
And I have to say, excellent book, a real page turner. That's Rendered Flesh by David Cartwright. I'd highly recommend it. Do check it out.
Oh, I've actually got a copy. I've just not got around to reading it yet. But
you'll enjoy it.
Yeah, he's a good mate of mine. So yeah, basically, Spall, he info dumps a little bit, doesn't he, about what's been going on? But it's done in such a funny way that you don't notice it's an info dump.
But also, they've got no memory of that. They think they're the Red Dwarf characters, you know, which I suppose you would 4 years in a game.
Exactly. Yeah, and it turns out that they've been playing it wrong. He's been the Pratt version of Rimmer, because apparently there's like a secret hidden in his swimming certificate, and the clue was the fact that Rimmer's got a swimming certificate but can't swim. He's hidden in a micro dot. Apparently he's like a secret agent or something, and he's had his memory wiped and he's programmed to act like a complete twonk, which I thought was genius. Yeah, they missed out on the planet of the nymphomaniacs.
Yes. Yeah. And Lister missed out on getting the girl as well, because he was supposed to in the thing.
Exactly.
And I like while they're talking about all this as well, the next batch come in, and they're all very sort of handsome looking chaps, aren't they? And it's just
macho. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, Lister, he's a beefcake, isn't he, man? He's this big oiled up muscle dude, you know. It's the like basically the anti of them, you know. The Rimmer's very suave and all the rest.
I did feel for him a bit, because this is like me with some of those puzzle computer games, right? So the idea was they were supposed to get into the Esperanto, and then they could have destroyed the squid with the guns from the Esperanto, which of course means hope
beats the squid. Yeah.
And that I'd be like, what, eh?
So I know, right?
I guess I'm a twonk.
So. Me too. I look for a walkthrough on the, you know, gamefaqs.com.
Google,
Then you read it and you go, oh, for fuck's sake, I'm an idiot. Yeah. And basically, Timothy Spall basically tells him to sod off, doesn't he? He's like, get out of the way, you bunch of idiots. And they go through to the recuperation lounge where they're given their personal effects. And this is where they find out who they
really are.
Really are.
In inverted commas, yeah.
Yeah. And the runaway hit of this whole episode in terms of the new character is Kat. Dwayne Dibley, like I mentioned, you know, he's the anti-cat. He's anorak, sandals, got a thermos, you know.
Well, is what you call your real stereotypical gamer, right? That's kind of what they've gone for.
It is, yeah.
It's like the pudding bowl haircut, like you say, everything's nylon and whatever.
Cardi.
Yeah, then there's the teeth.
Yeah. What the hell happened about teeth?
Yeah. What do you say? Teeth like these druids could worship them.
Yeah, teeth like druids could use as a place of worship. Yeah. And men hairs,
And they're all kind of the total antithesis of what they are in Red Dwarf, right? Because it turns out Lister is this sort of a high up in the, was he a voter colonel, is his rank?
Yeah, the voter colonel, the Ministry of Alterations.
Yes, yeah, which is again is the total opposite of his laid back, sort of hippie-ish kind of anarchist type character.
Yeah, and Rimmer's his brother.
Yes.
Who's a tramp.
That's right, yeah.
So he can no longer blame his shortcomings on his family and upbringing, because Lister's really successful.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the whole point. You can see where this is going, right? It's sort of chipping away at their sort of sanity, isn't it? They're all about to fail their sand rolls.
Yes. You know? Yeah. But that was nice, because this isn't, you know, you see the monster, you lose your sand. This is quite a subtle thing. I mean, you could almost see this as a plot of a film, couldn't you?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, we've mentioned The Matrix, really, that gradual unravelling of your whole identity.
Yeah.
This is the same thing, but packed into a 30-minute comedy. But again, quite dark and deep themes.
Oh, yeah, very much so. Very much so. And my other favourite is Crichton, who's Jake Bullitt. Cybernautic detective, right? He goes on this big rant about you know, there's pen pushers at City Hall. They don't like it. They can park their overpaid fat asses on this mid-digit and swivel till they squeal like pigs on a honeymoon. And then Rimmer types up, on the other hand, Mr. Bullet, Cybernautic Division could be in charge of traffic control and you could just have a rather silly macho name, which turns out to be true.
Turns out to be exactly the case. Yeah, yeah. It's basically is like a sort of traffic warden.
So, yeah. Yeah. Which brings us to that they basically leave before they've got their memories back. Lister's got like a limo in the long-term car park and they're going to go and get it and get out of there. And this kid runs past, followed by a guy in a trench coat with a gun.
Yep.
Who is another brilliant guest cast. And this is where the Francis Barber connection comes in, because Francis Barber was a friend of this actor and she recommended him.
Oh, wow.
So there you go. And that was Mr. Lenny Von Dolan,
right,
who is best known for playing the orchid-loving agoraphobe Harold Smith in Twin Peaks.
Ah, that's where I recognise him.
Yeah, he's from Twin Peaks. Mm. Yeah.
That's another, well, yeah. we might even include that in this series, or one of our guests might choose that. But,
yeah. Yeah, it's another one, isn't it? Yeah, apparently the kid had stolen an apple of the people.
And the sentence is death.
And this is where you find out about the about Lister's job, the voter colonel, the Ministry of Alteration, because he's all sort of like kowtowing to him, isn't he? Sort of like, oh, yeah. Apologies, voter colonel, apologies. And there's all these posters on the wall. Vote fascist.
Vote fascist, yeah.
For a third glorious Reich or whatever that it is. And what's my favourite one is the post that's like, be a government informer, betray your family and friends. Fabulous prizes to be won.
Fabulous prizes, exactly. Yeah. Well,
it's not that far-fetched, is it?
It's not a million miles away, is it, in some respects? Yeah. And I thought, again, this is another way to get your background across rather than just a big slab of exposition.
Yeah.
Because Lister says to this guy, well, who am I? And it was like, oh, is this a test?
Yeah.
But by doing this, then we get the background to the character and everything else. So, yeah, very neatly done. They package quite a lot in, don't they, in this?
It always amazes me with those, especially like series 4 to 6. They were basically like mini movies each episode because they were the action-packed series. They were the ones that went proper action with it. And, yeah, they were all like mini movies. I mean, they got so much in there. It's like, God, it must have been a nightmare to film them, because there's a lot going on, right, on a BBC budget.
Well, yeah, considering all that as well. I mean, and it all still looks great as well, right? You know, this isn't like cheap sets or anything like that. It's all looking good. Oh, and we should mention as well the lithium carbonate.
Indeed.
Because that comes into play at a point here. Crichton, when they got back to the ship, well, was it Holly who suggested they take lithium carbonate?
No, it's Crichton in the lift.
It was Crichton, right, yeah.
Yeah, when they're all in the lift and they start crying.
That's it, yeah. Yeah, to counter the effects of the despair.
Food stabilizer.
And I'm guessing that is just what people take today, right? The lithium tablets. Yeah, lithium. Yeah. Yeah.
Which I've taken.
Right.
Yeah. I've prescribed it for a while.
Oh, right. But, yeah.
Basically, this shadowy guy gets his gun out and he's going to take a shot at the kid. Crichton pops him in the head. So that's Crichton's Sanrol fail, because he just killed a human. And he's a mechanoid.
Yes, yeah, he's an android. And yeah, so is it the first rule of robotics, isn't it?
Asimov's law, yeah. Exactly, there you go.
Yeah. So another Sanrol. Yeah.
And then probably one of the funniest scenes ever recorded, because now you get the reveal. He's there, he's I killed him, I killed a human. And it cuts back to Starbug. And Holly's going, you're hallucinating. Can you hear me? He's there waving a crossbow around, right?
But this was done quite at first. It was just almost like a little jump cut, wasn't it? Boom, and then back again. You think, what's going on there?
Yeah.
And then each time they go back to the Starbug to reality, it gets a little bit longer.
Yeah. And that this scene, oh, my love.
The hilarious chase. The chase.
It's so clever as well, because there's no way they could have afforded to mount a car chase
and a helicopter and rocket
and a helicopter rocket launches.
Yeah, the full lot, wasn't it? Yeah.
So what they do is that they're in Starbug, they're sitting on crates, and they're doing that wonderful Star Trek acting of like, chicane, and they all go to the left.
They all go to the left.
Speed bumps, they all go
jump. Yeah, that was so funny.
So well done. There's a brilliant outtake of when they were doing that, and they do the speed bump bit, and I think it's Cat goes backwards off the legs in the air. Yeah, it just slays me every time that, and no matter how many times I see that scene, it's still funny because it's just so perfectly done. You've got to remember they did that live in front of an audience.
Yeah.
At Shepperton Studios under fuckloads of pressure, and it's just so well done.
Yeah, and again, I can imagine, as we said, we've got a lot packed into an episode. Can't imagine they had a lot of time to film these things, given budgets, to, you know, and everything else. They probably got a couple of days to get everything done.
So. Pretty much, yeah. Yeah. It's just brilliant. And then they ditch the car and they run around the thing a few times until Kat says, down in that alley, and then it cuts back to the other world, the fantasy world.
Yeah.
And that's when the sort of denouement, you know, Crichton's going to shoot himself because he killed a human. And the rest of them go, well, I'm a mass murderer.
Yeah.
Dwayne Dibley.
Yeah, he can't live as Dwayne Dibley.
He can't live as Dwayne Dibley. And Rimmer can't live as being a tramp because he's such a, you know, all the rest of it. So, yeah. They've only got one bullet, so they decide to put their heads together.
Yeah, I'm sure that would work, right?
And that's when Holly transmits on a different frequency and gets through to Crichton and basically tells him to go and move over there, pick up the fire extinguisher. And he's like, I think I'm going to pick up this fire extinguisher and turn the release valve. Well, he's lost it, but it's lithium carbonate.
So that brings them out of it and back to the actual reality, not the virtual reality.
Indeed.
And it's just this sort of casual way that the Despair Squid is then. Or what happened to the Despair Squid? Oh, limpet mines, which I thought limpet. That's quite a nice little thing.
Yeah,
it's basically I've turned it into calamari.
Yeah, enough calamari out there to feed the entirety of Italy. You've got this wonderful line right at the end. Lister sitting there, and he sort of eulogizes a little bit, doesn't he? And he goes, these engineers really messed up here, didn't they? Playing God.
Yeah.
All the rest of it.
That's that British comedy thing, right? You've got all the humour. There's that element of tragedy, but then there's that little moment.
Mm.
Humans spread despair wherever they go.
Yeah, because that's Crichton's line, isn't it? Sounds not unlike a species sitting not a million miles away from me now, sir.
Yes.
A brilliant episode. Absolutely brilliant episode.
Yeah, and this brought me back, I think we've mentioned this before, was the Chang Zhu story, you know, the man who dreamt he was a butterfly.
Mm.
And is he a butterfly dreaming as a man? Or that kind of spinning round of your whole view of reality and what is exactly real and isn't. And you sort of think, even coming out of this, even though they know that was a hallucination, there'd still be a little element of doubt, perhaps. Yeah, but was it really? Am I going to wake up again? Have I gone back into the game?
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, was it? Well, we did really crap the first time. Let's go and try again. You know, you could see how that could be weaved in, couldn't you? Really?
Yeah. Which is kind of what they did with a few years later. They did. It was basically series 9, but it was like a 3-part mini series called Back to Earth.
Right.
And it was the first one they did. It was when they resurrected the show because it had been away for a while. And it wasn't great, to be honest, but part of that was the way it was shot. It was all done on film and it kind of lost something, but it had some great moments. And the concept of that, basically, it's a sequel to Back to Reality. But in that one, it's not a despair squid. It's a hope squid.
Ah, that's interesting.
That Cat picked up on an ocean planet when it was a little bitty squid and has kept it in the water tank because he's a cat. He wanted it to grow so he could eat it.
Yeah. That's a cat.
And you get this awesome... this time they go full-on rubber tentacles, right? They're in this diving bell and they go down into the water tank and there's these pink rubber tentacles flapping around, right? That's brilliant. And and then they go back to Earth, but they find out that it's really meta, for fourth wall breaking. They find out that they're fictional characters and they they go to Coronation Street and meet the real Craig Charles and all this kind of stuff. But it's basically a riff on Blade Runner.
Right.
And so you got the classic, I want more life, smegger. But you got all the beats in there. You got the guy who designs the costumes, and like the guy who does the eyes in Blade Runner, right? And all this kind of stuff. Yeah. And you've got a riff on that classic glass shattering scene and all that kind of thing. Mm. And at the end of it, Kachansky turns up, because she's dead in that series. She dies somewhere between the 8th and 9th series, apparently. But she doesn't really. She basically left, but Crichton lied.
Right.
But anyway, so Lister's reunited, and that's when they finally draw the curtain back, and you realise that Lister is basically in a coma.
Wow.
He's been squidded, and basically, because he's reunited, so he's basically getting his happy ending. So this squid is killing him with his happy ending.
Killing him with hope and happiness.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. Which I thought was a really nice way of doing it. So it's a shame that the wasn't shot in the same way. And I think it got unfairly slammed at the time. But if you go back and watch it, there is a lot in there to like in that. Especially if you watch it back to back with that one.
With that episode, yeah. Well, I think anything like that, where you get a series that's run for that long and is that that huge fandom. I mean, this was getting like 6-7 million viewers, at least at the time. It, mm-hmm. it was for a again inverted commas cult show. It was huge. That's going to build up a lot of expectation.
Yeah,
and any of those things never quite seem to work, do they? I'm trying to think of other examples where they bring something back, or it was always they make a movie, didn't they? You have a good series, and then they make a movie spin-off.
Yeah,
and it's never quite the same.
Funnily enough, after that they. They're still making it, and they did 3 more series, but they took it back to Shepperton and did it properly,
right.
And they have been absolutely superb, absolutely right. Spot on.
And it's the same writing team, is it?
Same people, same writing team, same cast.
Yeah.
Some of the funniest episodes have actually been in these later series, but not that many people have watched them because they're on Dave. It's
well
not
now
BBC.
It's all different now, isn't it, in terms of that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there's certain episodes, like, you know, the one with the Lister falling in love with the vending machines, that was in like series 10, I think. That was absolutely, it's one of my favorites. Another one is when they decide to get a new ship's computer, and they end up with this crazy goth that can predict the future. Basically goes full on hell and tries to kill them all. I'm saving time, so I'm just going to push you out the airlock to save time, because you're going to end up coming out of the airlock because you're doing it. It's just really well done, really clever. And Crichton meets God because he has a midlife crisis. It's just bonkers stuff. But they actually did a film a couple of years ago. The most recent thing was a film.
Oh, right. Is that the one they shot, but it wasn't quite... Because I know there was a US TV version, but I didn't know about the movie.
Yeah, no, they tried to do a movie a few times,
right.
And it happened, nearly happened, then it didn't happen. Yeah, the American version, don't bother.
Yeah, it didn't get past the pilot stage, apparently. And it does that thing they always do. They did it with 40 Towers, and they just suck all the humour out of it, pretty much.
It's terrible. It's like Lister's all wrong, because, again, he's handsome and... all quite beefy and all the rest of it, and they've just missed the point on it. Because it's actually included as an extra on one of the DVDs.
Oh, right.
So I've got it. Well, I've watched it once and never wanted to see it ever again. It's really bad.
I think that type of humour doesn't always translate very well. There's something quite British about it. I mean, you can talk Monty Python and all those things.
It's terribly British.
There's so many things wrapped up in there about class and status and all sorts of...
Well, especially with Rimmer, right? That's the whole point of Rimmer.
Yeah,
is that is his entire thing, is the class system.
Yeah, because I remember seeing an episode of the 40 Towers one, and that just didn't work either. I think the only one that did work was The Office.
That's a universal thing, right? There's going to be dickheads in offices anywhere, you know?
Yeah, and they didn't try and copy it too much. They took the basic characters, but then they adapted it.
Yeah,
like you say, that's universal. Idiot boss all the rest of it.
But that's an indication of how popular it was, because you mentioned the American series and like the viewership they were having. In just I think it was just after they finished Series 8. They did, they were, BBC had a Red Dwarf night.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I remember that.
So the entirety of the broadcasting that night was Red Dwarf-related stuff. Yeah. So they played, like, a couple of the best episodes, a compilation of outtakes, and then some random bits. So you had, like, a universe challenge. It was, like, university challenge, but it was all, like, questions about Red Dwarf, and it was against, like, it was the cast versus some super fans,
right?
And it was hilarious because the cast didn't have a clue, right? But the best one was Can't Smeg, Won't Smeg, which was Can't Cook, Won't Cook, which was hosted by Ainsley Herriot.
Oh, brilliant, brilliant.
So there full you circle. Go, full circle. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it was so funny because, yeah, it was a Lister versus Crichton. And they were in character, and they were like cooking space weevil and all this sort of stuff, and ridiculous. And they and Chloe as a Kachansky had to taste this nightmare. That they it was just really funny. And I think, in only my to my knowledge, they've only really done that with. I mean, they've done it with Doctor Who a few times. I think they did a Star Trek night. But it's up there in terms of, you know, elite shows that, you know, it has an entire block of BBC programming dedicated to it.
Well, it's like your Dad's Army, isn't it? It's on a level with that kind of classic show.
It is, yeah.
Which is quite surprising in some ways. But then again, this is a generation that grew up with computer games and video games and all the horror films and sci-fi, every reference. As we said, they drew on contemporary sci-fi. But then also brought their own ideas in as well.
Oh, yeah.
Which is why it's not just a parody of Alien or Lost in Space, is it? It goes beyond that.
They do have bits of it, but it's got its own identity very much. And it, like again, with some of the concepts, like they go to a planet which is a psi moon. So it's basically a moon that attaches to somebody's psyche and terraforms itself around it. So because, but it obviously it's Rimmer, isn't it? So it turns into a hellscape. You know, you got the swamp of despair, the river of worthlessness. It's all these neuroses come to life, right? And things like that. And you've got a lot of stuff with wormholes and things like when you go to a reality, a backwards reality and all this.
Yeah. Yeah. They did a lot of that playing around with reality and time travel. Yeah.
There was a lot going on. It was like, it wasn't just like your sort of no-brainer sitcom. There was a lot going on.
Well, I'm trying to think of an equivalent sort of show that you'd have. A sort of sitcom in space where they travel and they meet funny aliens.
Well, later on you had Hyperdrive, which had Nick Frost in it, which was actually very good. It was very funny, but that was basically just Star Trek, but a comedy version.
I didn't see that.
I think it only ran for like one or two series.
Because I think when you parody something, you've got to do it really, really well. Like Spinal Tap's probably the ultimate example, right?
Absolutely.
That's a film I can watch over and over. And then all the little spin-offs, the interviews and all that stuff.
Bad News as well from the comic strip.
Oh, Bad News,
Rick and Aid, you know, that was... Because I've lived with somebody who was basically like Vim Fuego.
I think we all know anyone who's been in a couple of bands will know a Vim.
Yeah, we all know a Vim Fuego, don't we? Lead guitarist.
The talent here.
Yeah. We all know a Vim Fuego. Yeah,
absolutely. So I think there's some people that can do that parody very well. But when it's done, I suppose it's a kind of a lazy, it's an easy thing to do, isn't it?
Indeed.
To take something like Star Trek and we'll have a guy with pointy ears and et cetera, et cetera. But once you get beyond those jokes, there's not often a lot of depth.
But it seems that they took more inspiration, not really that much inspiration from Star Trek that I can see, because it's more sort of Asimov and that kind of thing. I mean, because
it's more like more sort of gritty science fiction. Like it's a mining ship, right? They're not space explorers or a naval force or anything like that. They're going around digging stuff out of asteroids, basically.
Yeah, basically. Yeah, that's it. And the universe is run by these corporations. And so it's got that more sort of dystopian feel to it. You know, it's more in line with that kind of that kind of sci-fi, the sort of sci-fi that I really like, that kind of like the stuff that's not a million miles away from the truth, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, you look 100 years ahead or whatever and you think, well,
exactly.
who knows? And this went beyond TV as well, because there were books, mm-hmm. there was a magazine, and this is something I didn't know. There was an RPG brought out in 2003 as well.
I didn't know that.
By Deep Seven Press. So I think there was like a core rule book and then a couple of supplements as well. Never seen it, never played it. I'd be very interested to hear if anyone has.
I might have to try and track a copy of that down, because I'd love to have a crack at that.
Yeah. Apparently it was fairly rules light kind of system, but I guess it was played as a comedy game in a sense. You know.
Yeah. Well, to be fair, there is like Red Dwarf conventions.
Right.
So I imagine it's a con game.
Right, right. Yeah. It's going to be something like that. Yeah. I mean, it puts me in mind of something like Paranoia, perhaps, or that kind of setup.
Ah, yes. Yeah.
Which
is
one of those favourite games that I've played only a few times, but really did enjoy. So maybe it's along those sort of lines.
Yeah.
But yeah, if anyone has played it, then do give us a shout.
Yeah. There hasn't been a full fat video game adaptation, but there was mobile games,
right?
Like flash games and stuff like that as well.
It'd be odd playing a video game, then you suddenly wake up somewhere else.
Yeah. Oh God, yeah. Art imitating life, imitating art, imitating life, and all that. Yeah.
We're going through the wormhole.
Yeah.
So yeah, and I think overall, I mean, we've touched on a lot of the concepts there, and it's easy to see how we can look at any of those through a Lovecraftian lens. I mean, even just the idea of, we said, the last man alive in 3 million years, there's our time and space, right? Our deep time and deep space.
Yeah. And then, like I say, you got the sirens, which are not a million miles away from psychic versions of the Mego, because they don't take your brain and put it in a jar. They just suck it out with a straw.
Well, it saves money on jars, and it saves washing up.
Yeah, exactly.
It's hard washing up with pincers. I don't know if you've ever tried. But,
Oven mitts, yeah.
Giving it all that.
Mm. Oh, God, that joke, yeah. Not coming in, giving it all that.
I'm afraid that's a visual joke, so you just have to imagine that.
It's a lobster walks into a bar, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, Migo walks into the Squid Inn.
Nice.
Speaking of which, I think Last Orders is going to be ringing soon, so indeed, we're going to wrap up and get all our guests here back on the bus. I'm sure if you haven't finished your Sea Nuggets, I'm sure you can get a doggy bag from an Innsbruck doggy bag, just to take those with you.
Nice.
Just don't leave any crumbs on the bus, because...
Yeah, Mr. Sergeant doesn't like that, does he? Does get the ump, doesn't he? Yeah.
Okay, so that's our first in our TV series, Red Dwarf, an excellent choice. And I think it's just one of those you can watch again and again, isn't it, really?
Yeah. I've honestly seen that episode like at least 50 times.
Yeah.
You know, it's always one of them. If I think, oh, we'll watch Red Dwarf, oh, I'll put that one on. And it's like watching it this morning, it still makes me laugh, even though I know what's coming, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah. So next time it's going to be my first choice, and we're sticking with an outer space theme, but this is more outer space coming to visit us. Because we're going to be looking at the Gerry Anderson series UFO, which was, of course, the Andersons are very famous for Thunderbirds and Captain Scarlet and the Puppets. This was it was kind of their second venture into live action. They did do one series that was a mixture of puppets and live action, featuring Stanley Unwin, which was a little bit of a bizarre one. But UFO was the first of their live action series. We'll get onto that next time. And it's my favourite theme tune of all time. So we'll speak about that as well.
We should have a bingo card, and basically every time one of us mentions probing, we...
Yes, there's a bit of probing, I'm sure.
Mm.
Yeah, there's certainly some surgical scenes that I remember at the time were quite full on. Just before we hop back on the bus then, you may remember last time we were talking about some issues with our RSS feed on Patreon. Well, there's been some delving going on. There's been some consultation of archaic texts. And it looks like basically the problem is this is because we switched over to our uploading our episodes to Buzzsprout rather than Patreon. So we're going to look into that. Can we give patrons an RSS link to Buzzsprout? Or if push comes to shove, what we do is upload those missing episodes onto Patreon. Then you should get the link for those as well. So thanks for your patience again. Do bear with us. And hopefully we'll have that sorted out sometime in the next couple of weeks.
I still don't know what it is.
And I don't know enough to explain it very well. So.
No. He did try, but I'm still none the wiser. I think it's just one of those things that my brain refuses to take in.
Well, how Lovecraftian is that, you know? It's just...
Yeah, yeah. The lurking RSS feed.
I think it's something to do with Azathoth or Nihilathotep, possibly, but, you know.
Oh, it's got to be old Gnarly, right?
Yeah.
It's got to be.
Oh, yeah. And speaking of Patreon, if you'd like to visit our Patreon page, you can, of course, sign up to support the show. You get bonus content for the Innsmouth Book Club and Strange Shadows, our Clark Ashton Smith podcast, which is just drawing to the end of its second season. I can't believe we've covered the first two volumes already.
No, that second one seemed to go really quickly for me. I don't know why. I think we're busy, like, arranging the ILF and all that kind of stuff. It's just kind of, it's gone. Yeah.
It kind of crept up, didn't it? That, all of a sudden we're on the last episode. So we're going to be doing a wrap-up show for that next week. And then over Christmas for the IBC and Strange Shadows, we'll be taking a bit of a break. But of course, we'll be putting out some content, some readings, and no doubt some bonus content for our patrons. And remember, as patrons, you also get discount on our Redbubble store. There's a message just gone out about that for patrons. And you get the quarterly copy of Innsmouth News as well. We're also going to be lining up some other benefits. Again, we'll be putting a message out to our patrons. But basically, for our higher tier members, if you want to come on the show and have a chat with us, either as a guest or if you want to join us for one of these episodes talking about your favourite Lovecraftian TV show, then you'd be most welcome. Thanks, as always, to all our existing patrons. Thanks to our subscribers on Buzzsprout and our subscribers on YouTube. As always, your input is welcome. Your thoughts, comments, suggestions, or perhaps you could let us know if this is a reality, or are we all part of some simulation? Are we the dream of a mad god, or are we a mad god having a dream? I'm not sure which.
There we go. Yeah. I'm pretty sure if it is a video game, I'm going to get a really crap score.
You twonk.
I'm going to be a twonk. Yeah.
All right. And on that note, thanks very much for listening, folks. We'll see you next time. It's goodbye from me, Rob Poyton.
And it's goodbye from me, Tim Mendes.